Welcome. It's a delight to be here in our seminar series of 8 weeks. And it's even more of a delight to welcome Dr. Pali Lahola, who, as many of you know, for a great many years, 17 years, has been Statistician General of South Africa and has recently stepped down. But in that period, what's very striking for those of you who know Pali is that he's not only the head of Statistics South Africa with all of its creativity and ingenuity in a historic period of its development. But he's also very much a little bit of a rock star among statisticians. Because if you picture all the statisticians, you don't need it. Picture all the statisticians in a statistics commission or something, they tend to be quite quiet people. And Pali is just a breath of fresh air. And very much somebody who's been able to mobilize, been able to articulate the needs of statistics to change in a time when there's been changes in information technology systems, changes in how data are collected, changes in geospatial mapping, and changes in the sustainable development goals, and the prominence that statistics now has to be used for policy. So it's really an honor, a very deep personal honor, to have you with us, Pali, and to have the chance to hear from you. Given all of the many horizons that you have in your mind that many of us do not have, to hear how multidimensional poverty fits in to that horizon and what we could do to make it better. So Pali will present, and then there'll be a space for questions and answers afterwards. For those who are joining by video, welcome. And this session is being videoed. And so if there are concerns, then please speak to us before you go. Thank you so much, and over to you.
Thank you very much, Sabina, for that introduction. I had the benefit of meeting a few people before this, and they have expressed high expectations. And I was once in Bishkek, and I didn't speak Russian, and my host also didn't speak English. So we adopted sign language. The first thing that we discussed was what sports both of us like. And we happened to like the same sport, which was volleyball, to which he immediately invited me, and I accepted the invitation, having not played volleyball for a number of years, but that was the last sport I played. And as I entered the arena, there was a standing ovation in anticipation of a good game. And as it happened, after about 3 minutes of failing to jump as high and smashing the balls over the net, the expectations were soon dampened by the reality of my performance. I suppose that it may not be so now. Sabina says I'm a rock star. Well, I do sing, and on our Women's Day in South Africa, I shared the stage with those who are from Southern Africa, Matlatin and the Mhotela Queens, and I did my bit there, and there were quite some good accolades around my performance. And I suspect that that might be what I do as I leave office. Retirement is a euphemism for contract has ended. My contract ended on the 31st of October, having worked for 17 years. Of course, when we have worked on a contract for 17 years, it ceases to be a contract. And I think the only decent thing you can say is you have retired. So I've stepped down from being a Statistician General of South Africa, having worked there for 17 years and done duty in the statistics system of South Africa for 34 years. So I've seen the apartheid period, I've seen the post-apartheid period. I could say I've seen quite a bit in the world of statistics. What am I going to talk about? The multi-dimensional poverty indices. And it's a very provoking subject to study poverty and to think about what will happen in the future. And I've been provoked by it over a period of time to think about, it can't just be an observation, it can't just be reporting, it can be monitoring, but It has to do with planning. And the point that I would be arguing is that the next phase of multidimensional poverty indices should be how it can be used as a planning tool, not just observation and monitoring. In the space of planning, I think it has exemplified itself and distinguished itself as a prioritization tool. So coming to the outline of my presentation, I've tried to look at the MPI as part of the an array or arsenal of statistical tools and being used in planning. So I would like to argue that MPI should be a planning tool, should be a part of that arsenal, because it provides results for interventions. It distinctly says that, well, these are the priorities. If you were to ask what prioritize afflict you as a country from a poverty perspective, these are the priorities you'll have to address. And having done that, one has to ponder, how does it become a planning tool? And I think this is the juncture at which it gets very complex as to how does it become that? I do not know how it becomes that, but I would ponder a few points. And how does it become not only a planning tool, but for shared demographic transitions and dividends? Because the world is actually going through several transitions. Western Europe here, people are aging. In Asia, they are almost in that space where the dividend is at its optimum. In Africa, it's a demographic transition without a dividend. So for across all those three spheres of transitions, how do these shared dividends become obvious through something like multidimensional poverty? Because poverties will manifest themselves in those different spheres because of the challenges that emergent. And then, of course, what the research agenda might be in order to embed MPI as a planning tool. I don't portend or suggest that I have answers to this, but I think these are things that are very clear in my head, require attention. As a statistician, there are things that we produce from the national account. The national account is a very criticized instrument, and of course, I think it's criticized because many use it wrongly. But there are a few things that come out of the national account, such as input-output tables. That is what is from the supply and use, what do you supply and what do you use it for? It's a 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, a very complex matrix. But then there is an input-output table, like such as the one like Leontief input-output table. I'm not going to elaborate on that. There's growth accounting framework and the social accounting matrix. And these are applied in national accounts to validate the quality of the national account that it balances. But when you flip those tools, they actually become very, very veritable planning tools. And they are byproducts that can be used in planning. Hardly ever used in many African countries, in many countries, partly because of the data gaps that are there in this, and partly because they are not actually used in planning, such as you would have used them in a Leontief input-output table. So what is the growth accounting framework? The aim of the growth accounting framework is to increase incomes. And in increasing incomes, the impact on labor productivity. You look at labor productivity, you look at labor absorption rates, or labor absorption rates as well as terms of trade. That's what the growth accounting framework does. And I think the kinds of questions from a multidimensional poverty indices, how do we impact on those? The social accounting framework, matrix, SAM, gives you categories of who benefits from prospects of growth and prospects of development. Is it black people? Is it white people? Is it through salaries? Is it through that? You can categorize this and understand who gets impacted. And of course, you can easily associate the social accounting matrix with the multidimensional poverty indices. And then, of course, the input-output tables, I've already spoken about that, that it's a square matrix that gives you coefficients across that matrix of what is input and what is coming out as output in that closed matrix. And you can ask the question if it's a product such as milk, which is applied in the production of cheese, in the production of other things that milk products produce, and who is employed in the production of this, that cereal, or in household final consumption, and who are involved in that production schema. Now, the question is that we have never answered and answered correctly, what informs priorities? In South Africa in 2002, there was an adoption of rural development, integrated sustainable development program, ISRDP, largely looking at integrated development for rural and urban areas. And a very interesting program, which was called NODES. And of course, in this NODES, one was looking at how effectively and efficiently you respond to needs of disadvantaged communities in a manner that accelerates delivery. And this is the map of these nodes, and they largely were distributed in areas that were occupied by homelands. I used to work in this homeland here, which was Puputa Tswana. I used to stay somewhere here in Mabatu, running a homeland a statistics office before I moved to Pretoria, which is somewhere there, and finally headed that. But these are other areas that are homelands and that were identified as nodes. But when hindsight gives you perfect sight, in hindsight, you try to find out what actually informed people to select these nodes. And you see that these were nodes that were selected. And Itlazeni and Central Karoo were not as poor as any of the nodes that were selected. So the question was, what informed the selection? Obviously, the politicians didn't have the data, the statisticians didn't generate the data, so the people had to thumb suck and say, well, this must be priority areas. I mean, if the statisticians are delaying with the data, what can we do? There is a poverty on the ground, you can smell it, you can see it as people who run on the ground. So they selected those. So in hindsight, you can say, oh, what was the basis for your selection? Say, well, you didn't give me the data. I'll come back to this slide. In terms of multidimensional poverty, you can see here is Beaufort West with a poverty headcount of 6.2 and a poverty intensity of about 40.8. It was selected as a node. But you can see that here, there were areas that were having headcount of 60% and intensity of about 50% that were not nodes, you see. And you can see Vembe here, similarly, in the scheme of things, and the Greater Taung. And so basically, the choice of nodes had nothing to do with the level of either poverty intensity of, So, but those were the choices that were made. And when you look at multidimensional poverty, it really gives you a very clear picture of what, and here you could see, that's 2001, and this is one of the poorest, which is Msinga. And the ones that I've been showing you were somewhere here in terms of headcount and intensity. And over a period of time, it moved backwards. Over a period of time, it's because I anticipated this to move this way, so I pressed the button that goes that way. Yeah. So you can see over a period of time, headcount in Msinga from 60 in 100 dropped to 37 in 100. But you can see the movement is actually parallel and not diagonal, or at least tending to be diagonal. It means that, yes, there are things that you can deal with quite with a lot of speed that relate to headcount. And by 2016, 2017, you can see where the headcount has been. But only the Western Cape here, the municipality of Western Cape, managed to move a little bit more diagonally. But mostly it's been a horizontal move rather than a diagonal one dealing with this. So suggesting that probably dealing with intensity is much more challenging than dealing with headcount. Whatever I said, yes. One, the selection criteria was devoid of prioritizing what to select because the data can show us that. But of course, we can say also that at the time there was no data, we hadn't provided the data. But with data, probably selection could be better. So if we look at whether information is being used, that's the question that we want to ask. And there's something called Integrated Development Plan, which looks at local government plans. And when we looked at these local government plans, we realized that there isn't a lot of data that is used in designing these integrated development plans. And the claims that they make in terms of achievements or otherwise can be at times very, very spurious, that they are not the kinds of achievements that you would agree with, or the data would agree with. The quality of analysis is very poor, and the context and explanations are more driven by conjecture rather than actual data. And the indicators are not standardized, and you cannot really compare across. So this is the weakness that we find in our IDPs. The problem is when you have a lot of data, you can always critique. When you don't have none, you can't say a lot. Therefore, you can't be in the spotlight. So I mean, South Africa, because of the richness of the data it has, we can say a lot about what happens, but you can't say the same about many other countries where the data, where there is no data. So how do we look at what happened in these targeted nodes? This is where these nodes were in 2006 in terms of multidimensional poverty, headcount, and intensity. And going forward from 2011 to 2016, this is how they tended to perform. And you can see in a number of them, intensity, actually poverty intensity increased, but generally they moved in this particular direction. But if you were to ask anybody who was involved in these nodes now, what happened there, what were the programs implemented, what were the projects, very little that can be said about what was happening there. So you could say that South Africa adopted a very clear spray gun approach to solving the problems of its development, and you didn't need to target, because even those where they were clear targeting, not much actually happened. There is no significant difference in the rate of change that occurred in nodes and non-nodes. And you can do that by using multidimensional poverty, showing you that retrospect after the fact. So what one is saying is in the future, you can actually use multidimensional poverty, and then follow through and see what is happening. Now, you can decompose segments of the population that are affected mostly by poverty. And here is what you can see in South Africa, and you can do that over time. Here is where we looked at components of the drivers of poverty: unemployment, years of schooling, sanitation, assets such as housing, heating for energy, energy for heating water, energy for cooking, energy for lighting, school attendance, and child mortality. These are the dimensions that we thought would constitute poverty in South Africa, or define multi-dimensions of poverty in South Africa. And here we are measuring those across time, 2001, 2011, 2016, and for each one of these it's the same. Now, what is very clear is that unemployment is the key driver of poverty in South Africa, moving from contributing 33% in 2001 to contributing 40% in 2011 and 52% in 2016. What is very important is that you can see that there is acceleration. Here it's moving at 7 percentage points different change in 5 years and 12 percentage points, or rather in 10 years and 12 percentage points in 5 years. So there's acceleration of poverty as a driver of poverty, or unemployment as a driver of poverty. And associated with it, of course, there's been a reduction in the impact of no schooling on education, 16, 14, and 11. But still, 11 plus 52 is 63% of drivers of poverty being limited years of schooling and unemployment. And these are very, very much linked anyway. And sanitation and all these others, you can see sanitation movement is only 0.1 percentage point here. I mean, assets, transfer of assets, housing, RDP houses, 3% from that. But generally, very little movement, although in the aggregate, they give you about 37%, the balance of 62%, that would be 38%, all this contribute that, but quite differential in the way they move. So in terms of prioritization, if you were to ask the South African government based on the statistics, they would say, well, unemployment and education are the key things that we have to focus on. Now, the question is how much is spent on sanitation and this year in, year out. And, of course, things have to be maintained here. But the question is how much of the resource is being applied here relative to what has to be applied in those key drivers of poverty. So multidimensional poverty in terms of prioritization is very, very crucial. And as you have seen, that we can deal with this at the level of municipalities. Ideally, you can talk about that prioritization at each one of these circles here, which are your municipalities, and have society and communities engaging on this at that kind of level. That's the power of multidimensional poverty. So from a planning perspective or priority setting perspective, and public mobilization and public participation, this is now possible to do using multidimensional poverty. And using these elements across space and time, at least for the public to participate. Now, when you, this is a multidimensional poverty for all households, that is households irrespective of age and so on. But we wanted to see now, how do the youth fit in this multidimensional poverty? And here you can see that those who are 15 to 24, instead of unemployment, it's actually what attainment in education they have, which corresponds very clearly to this part here, that their key driver of poverty is the level at which they attain what educational attainment they have. Of course, is there an adult unemployment, not in education, not in employment, and not in training. And then those things like water, energy, sanitation, and so on are not as important. In fact, unemployment is not as important as is the absence of education, and that defines what determines how poor they will be in the future. And if you think about the discussions in South Africa now, fees must fall, and the students are saying we want free education. It's a very clear aspect of public discourse, and they can participate and claim their space in that regard. Now, what would be there beyond prioritization and, of course, claiming your own space in this discourse of development? And how would multidimensional poverty indices work? Obviously, what we produce are these kinds of numbers, such as consumer price index, labor force, whether people are employed or not employed, what happens in the trade statistics, whether people buy in wholesale, retail, and so on. But what we do is, I've spoken about the social accounting matrix, input-output table, and growth accounting framework as qualitatively different products that arise out of this. So is the multi-dimensional poverty indices. They fit in here, in this space, where the data has been digested in a way that it helps the planner to think about how to deal with level two issues of provision of basic analytical intelligence. And then this level is modeling, where you really have a more advanced analytical. And this is the question that one has to ask. How does MPI fit in with these other tools? And that's really the key question. And given that, at least given the property of ability to get the public to participate, because I think it's a very strong aspect that the public can participate. So the MPI, as it sits here, one has to think about, and this is the question that one has to ask, how does it sit with within the social accounting matrix, within the growth accounting framework, within the ZIF, that ZIF is P here instead of F, and then in the input-output table. That's the intellectual question that we must engage. I'm thinking about it at the moment. I do not know how it does it, but I think it does relate to that. And the public participation capability that the MPI brings with it is a very important one, so that these things are not done in rarefied offices far away from where people actually work. And I think, how does the MPI enhance the desire to deal with shared demographic transitions and dividends? Because I think it plays a very crucial role there, because populations are at risk, whether rich or poor, given the demographic transitions that are taking place and the dividends or lack thereof. So here is how the portrait of the growth accounting framework. You can actually increase incomes per capita through a combination of how you increase your labor productivity in terms of employment or terms of trade. And in each of those, you can actually look at through this transmission mechanism, if you have everybody employed, who you can actually realize the demographic dividend. And if you don't, of course, you'll have a demographic disaster. And of course, terms of trade and labor productivity. And how then do you bring in into this space the multidimensional poverty indices as outputs from observation of what has happened, but as inputs into this planning system? It's, those are the questions that one has to think about in terms of multidimensional poverty. Now, if you think about the absolute numbers of people in Africa who are now 15 to 64 relative to those who are 15 to 64 in the absolute numbers, and in Asia, comparing each one quite independently, here the question of multidimensional poverty is very acute. And we can see that this population, 15 to 64, is actually continues to rise. And in time, because of that transition, every third person in about 50 years will be African on Earth. So that's that growth. Here you can see in Europe, that absolute number is dropping And those who are 65 and older, those who are retiring like myself, I'm not 65 yet though, but that's what's happening. And in Asia, that number is growing, and the 15 to 64 in absolute numbers is declining. Now, the MPI, obviously, as a tool, because this has different impacts, that has different impacts, and that will have different impacts, and one has to look at what are the likely poverty challenges that will face each one of those demographic trends. So it's very, very important to look at multidimensional poverty indices as instruments for embedding them in planning, but more importantly, as general instruments for looking at how society progresses. So whatever I said, I've said that you can actually distinguish between general households and the youth using multidimensional poverty indices. And you can actually use MPI, I think, in driving planning processes. And of course, we need to think about this when we think about direction, that policy, use of data, and how that illuminates the policy choices. I thought that I'll leave it at that. So I'm not saying what we do with multidimensional poverty in planning, but I think it's a big question that we have to explore, because multidimensional poverty indices do have a role to play in planning. They have a distinct role that they play in prioritization, and we need to start prioritizing. But to play that major role in planning, there will be a serious demand for data, such as from the social accounting matrix frequency, as well as input-output table at the detailed level of product. Thank you.
So one question on data and disaggregated data for using that. Another on why not use the MPI straight up. And then one, how do you take into account the fiscal constraints?
No, thank you. I'll probably answer the last one last, or the first one last, and run in reverse order, provided that I can connect my laptop. If not, it's all right, I'll answer it verbally. But I would like to answer it with an illustration. As I do so with an illustration, Sabine, I would like to be so transparent with what files I have on my laptop. So they cannot be. Well, what would you do when you do not have resources? That's the situation that we have in South Africa at the moment, that the estimated amount of money required to meet the free education for, or rather, education that is paid by taxpayers is 40 billion, and there is no 40 billion. The MPI points very clearly to that this is a priority that has to be met. This is where the planning process comes in. By what amount every year are you going to reduce the contribution of unemployment to poverty? Or what do you intend? How do you intend reducing the contribution of poverty, contribution of unemployment to poverty every year? By what margin do you want to reduce that? That's really the function of planning. And that's where the MPI, at least from a monitoring and observation point of view, allows you to decide. And that decision then has to be accompanied by a concrete action. If you don't have 40 billion, you don't have it. But if you continue not to have it, the end is very disastrous, as you can see from the MPI, that unemployment as a driver of poverty is accelerating. And if it accelerates, it will implode at one point in time, and you will not have a country. So the choice is, where do you prioritize? Do you prioritize water and sanitation and all these other things, which are very important in their own right, that you need people with water to have water, you need people to have sanitation so that they don't get disease. But by using these tools year in, year out, using them at a geographic level and municipality, then you can start addressing the problems rather than say we are trying. No. You have to demonstrate how you are trying, and it must show in the results. It can't just be you are trying. So I would argue that by planning for a particular outcome and staying the course towards that outcome is crucial. And that's where multidimensional poverty gives you the levers of change that you will require. Doesn't it work, Sabine?
No.
Then you see the problem is I have so many things that, let me see.
Very good.
Yes, but then I'm not intending to be that transparent with my files. I used to be a head of statistics, and I wouldn't say whether the government has made the right choice or the wrong choice. I would have just said the government has made a choice, and these are the numbers. Given the priority, given what we have seen, certainly by looking at providing education freely to students we have passed is the right thing to do. You see, South Africa is very interesting and very complex, and you know, there's the issue of rich parents must pay fees for their children, which is quite an interesting thing, and probably quite correct. But when you think about South African society, and think about choosing who you should pay for, a lot of like that, because in the end, you'll only end up with just a few. Just well, have a spray gun approach, pay for everybody who is deserving, who is qualified to study, who is passed. Because it makes more sense when you do that. Now, there is a court case that was adjudged, and one of the issues I was raising at the time when I was in the hearings was, you know, you want to measure the incomes of parents and subject the student to the incomes of the parents, when you know that the society is so broken and one parent will not come to the party, and you want to subject this person who wants to go to university to that kind of harassment, it's not fair. And there's a case that has been adjudged in court yesterday, where the parent was, the student was thrown out of campus because he's not paying fees. And one of the parents, the wife is being followed and asked to pay, and the husband is not paying. Now, why should you punish the student? It's the wrong thing. You cannot ask students to pay tax, to pay fees, because they don't work. It's the wrong request, it's the wrong ask. The ask has to be to the taxpayers, and then you organize how you tax them to pay fees for everybody. So our situation in South Africa is as though we don't understand the situation. 60% of fathers say they are married against 30% of mothers. So now, if you have that kind of situation, now tell me what is happening to the children. And you want to subject the children to that kind of harassment. It doesn't make sense. And I think at times our policies are out of touch with the reality that South Africans experience. And these are, one has to use these numbers in that kind of way. So that's answering a question that I think was profound, because I think it is that which society and policymakers appear not to appreciate, or appear not to want to appreciate. Why not use MPI directly as a planning tool? At times, I think from, if planning is defined as priority setting, technically engaging a combination of things across time to deliver particular outcomes, and so on and so on, I would say from a priority setting perspective, the MPI can be directly implemented as a planning tool. The complex part is how your observations have to be influenced such that they change over time. Because the MPI is an observation. But now you need to build MPI into the planning tools, and that's where I'm saying I'm not sure how we are going to do that, but I can see the desire for that happening. And it can join the array of tools such as the growth accounting framework, social accounting matrix, and the input-output output tables. And if we are to embed the elements of MPI throughout that, I think we can achieve a lot, particularly because of the strength of MPI from public participation perspective. I think as a basic, it allows the public to participate and advocate for their own rights. Now, coming to this other matter, allow me to be less transparent for a second. I want to be just less transparent for a second, yes.
Good, you're fine.
It's okay, yes. I want to start right in the middle to answer some of the question that was asked. I see. You see, in 1953, in Parliament of South Africa, on the 23rd or 25th of September 1953, Verwoerd, who was then the Minister of Bantu Education, who then became the Prime Minister of South Africa in 1961, said, "What is the use of teaching a Bantu child, and Bantu child meaning a black person, mathematics when it can't use it in practice?" And this created a condition for South Africa that was very, very difficult. And 20 years later, 23 years later in 1976, there was the Soweto uprising, where students said, "We can't be taught in Afrikaans because this teaching process is undermining ourselves, it's undermining everybody." But that is on top of not being taught mathematics as blacks. And of course, 40 years later, we see the hashtag Fees Must Fall. These are the struggles of learning amongst the youth in South Africa. And I don't think we have addressed this adequately. Despite 76, where students, this was a struggle of students of high school, with parents sitting there not actually taking, attending to this. Students' struggles at high school, 16, 15 years, 17 year olds, having to take the bullets. And now, 40 years later, in 2016, exactly 40 years from 1976, those who are at university say, no, we can't afford this education. We need to do something. And of course, they say decolonized education and everything, fees must fall. These are similar movements. It's the same kind of movement. From a multidimensional perspective, we have just demonstrated that because of all these layers and layers of discrimination that over time, poverty has become endemic in South Africa, and the driver is unemployment. Now, do we have the data to do this? If you look at the issue of demographic dividend, you can see that in South Africa, the data suggests that across time, there has been a demographic transition. Not to the extent that Singapore, if you look at the age group 15 to 64, not to the same extent as Singapore or South Korea. South Africa is more fitting with Latin America in terms of this transition. But the economies of these countries have grown quite differently. If you look at China, it's been pumping at 6.9 on average over 60 years. And South Africa has been only growing at about what? Where is it now? I can see it, 1%. So the key difference here is in the growth rate of the economy. Although there were the golden years, but the appropriation of those growth rates in the 60s of South Africa from gold went to whites and not to blacks. And that's the storyline that you see of Bantu education and all that. And this is the story of the economic growth in South Africa over a period of time, quarter on quarter. And of course, I've spoken about that gap. Where I want to get to is the transition in South Africa in terms of has been very dramatic in terms of drop in fertility, and it's been driven by more by migration than anything else. The migratory labor system, where you go and migrate and you go and work on the mines, you will be there for 12 months. It will be very wrong for when you come back home, you find that there is a child and you have never been home in 12 months. Yet life has to go on. So in a way, South Africa's brutal laws created conditions for family, not family planning, but birth control. Almost a crude method of birth control, like you would be culling animals. So people started using contraception as a consequence of base needs. Unlike in China and all other countries, of course in China, you had to say you will have only one child. In other countries, education was the driver. And that's the point in South Africa. So the data actually is there that tells us why we are where we are. And how then we may have to, so that's the question I'm trying to answer. And of course, you can see how the transition occurred. I don't need to go through that because it's going to take a lot of time. And these are what what successive demographic and health surveys show in terms of use of contraception and satisfaction with the use, and of course, what are things that were used in time. And of course, you can look at the spread of HIV and AIDS, and against a very low fertility regime, you would see that it was only injectables and these things that mothers-in-law wouldn't see. Those are the things that were used rather than condoms. Because if condoms were used extensively in South Africa, the HIV and AIDS pandemic wouldn't have occurred. So it's been a tragedy after tragedy in the demographic space. And what has happened, there's a consequence of that, but when you come to education and you look at the progression ratios by race, you can see, I mean, whites as early as 1950 already had grade 3, whereas only a small percentage of blacks had grade 3, 35% if you look at 1950. But over time, they, and then of course here is those who had grade 9 and there is grade 12. And the most devastating is this one. Is this. And this tells you by race what the progression ratios are. Amongst blacks, the progression ratios are dipping. So every successive cohort of blacks and colors is performing worse than the one before it. And that's not development. And of course, because people talk about numbers in the country, who do not understand anything about numbers. This was one by educator, Mr. Spall, said, oh, blacks are doing very well. Look at them, in 1986, only 5,000 graduated. Look at them now. Number of years, 2016, 48,000 have graduated. Tenfold. The reality is, this is what the growth of blacks has been. It's not this one. How can you put absolute numbers and compare them without a base? These are some of the things that come into the public space and public discourse that are very distorting. And politicians like this story here. This one is a little bit too difficult to swallow. So anyway, let me leave it there. I was answering the question, is there a basket of data? In South Africa, there is lots of data. And of course, we can critique quite, and of course, the South African environment becomes very difficult because then it gets criticized because there is a better lens. And I suppose one would say how we wish we couldn't have a better lens so that we don't get onto the spotlight in the way we did. No, thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Bali. It's just fantastic to have you here. I hope this is an ongoing conversation. And Bali has also been, for since 2013, a steering committee member of the Multidimensional Poverty Peer Network, launched here with 54 participating countries, which basically supports the development of national MPIs and innovative uses of MPIs. And so Bali's work and the work of others is also available on that website. But thank you so much. This is the close of our seminar series for this term, and so we'll be back with you after the polling.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.